our fifth week on freedom, freedom discovering the divine you. And let me explain what that means. We believe that God has designed us on purpose for a purpose. For example, engineers, when they decide to make a new car or something like that, what do? They think about what's needed. We need to build this car or build this tractor or whatever. They think about it, and then what do? They draw up plans, they make blueprints, they plan it, and then they execute it. Before the foundation of the world, God says, I thought about you and I knew you. Before in your mother's moon, her womb, I designed you. And so we believe that every single person has a divine purpose from God. The problem is that the enemy and our own selves, that we walk away from that promises and also the opportunity. And our objective here at Cornerstone is to help people find the reason why they're alive and help them to thrive. It's not just about getting you to heaven. It's about bringing heaven to earth. And that's why God has given us the church. You see, and so we've been talking about freedom and how sometimes you and I can get ourselves into imprisonment or bondage to sin in different situations. We've been talking about that. And today we're continuing with that. And what I'd like to do is take a few moments just to kind of lay a little more of a framework for you. We spoke about a couple of weeks ago that pride is the major area that the enemy uses to entrap us. Pride, huge. It's like the master key to the house of our life. If he gets into our front door, he can go to every single area with that master key of pride. It is huge. But under that master key of pride, there's different areas, and today we're going to talk about it. But I also wanted to bring some attention to you today as well, that Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And they said to him, the church of his day, hey, what do you mean? We've never been in bondage to anyone. Jesus said, anyone that sins is a slave to sin. And I have a feeling that some of you might have sinned this past week. I did. So we don't do everything we're supposed to do. We have bondage in our life. We want to get free of entrapments. We want to get free of that. So we've been talking about that. Now I want to bring some attention to something here that's been controversial in the church. It does not need to be. And as a result of that, if people don't realize they can't be in bondage, they can't get free. Right? If you don't realize you're locked up, then how are you supposed to get free? Let me make something very clear to you, that the enemy's job is to lie, kill, and destroy. Another thing is this. The Bible, when it was translated from the original Greek into the English language back with the King James Version back in the 1600s, a long time ago, they used the word for demonized as possessed. And so possessed, according to the dictionary, means complete ownership. And people say, no, a Christian can't have a demon. Now, you're probably saying, they're talking about demons? What kind of church is it? Well, hang on. A Christian cannot be possessed by a demon because where there's light, there cannot be darkness. And where there's oil, there cannot be water. And God, no, that can't happen. And I would agree with you 100% that if you're giving your life to Christ, you're Christ. Your life's not your own. God has ownership. But the actual word, the Greek word, is not really possession. It's demonized, which is like infested. Now, some of you I know that have had termites in your home. You can't see them, but they get involved in the home. How about this? You may have rats, hopefully not, mice, roaches, ants, bees, which I'm dealing with right now. I got to figure out how to get rid of the bees. Yes, they're sleeping right now, but they're coming back. So I got bees in my attic. I need to get rid of those things, right? So they don't own the home, but they have influence, and they are a pest. Or if you're under the influence, if you drink too much alcohol, you can get drunk and you're under the influence. Does the alcohol own you? No, but it does affect you. So you can be under the influence of the enemy. Now, so as a result of that, Christians can be unduly influenced by the enemy. And I want to make something else very clear to you today. I know it's popular today, the yin and the yang. People got yin and yang jewelry on it. It looks nice and all that. Well, you know, you need to have a little bit of the, it's almost like Star Wars theology, the good force, the bad force. The truth of the matter is God is a lot stronger than the enemy. Big time. There's not even a contest. Not even a contest. However, the area where the enemy gains a foothold is through lies. Let me give you a better example. I want to set a little more groundwork here for us that maybe never been here before. It's this. You ever hear of ISIS? Yeah. ISIS and Al-Qaeda, they're what? They're terrorists. Now, there's no doubt in my mind that the United States of America could blow away ISIS or Al-Qaeda in a second, right? They're weak. They're just scattered. But they're terrorists. And how do terrorists gain control of our, look, our airports have changed, our security, don't you hate going to the airport now? All right, a lot of things have changed because of these terrorists. And what do? They can't beat us, so what do? They get us to be afraid so we change our lives. Walk around, oh my gosh, a bomb might go off. You start worrying about all these things, about ISIS, and start worrying about, and it could create terror. All right? And because they don't have the power to have an army to come against any of these countries, they're puny and weak. The enemy's the same way. He is a master terrorist. And he has a terrorist cells all around the world. There's a spiritual side. Now, if I had the opportunity today, if I could hand out to you, you ever go to the movies, you have 3D glasses? If I could hand out glasses today, I'm going to ask the ushers to bring glasses out. We had these special glasses today that when you put them on, you see demons and angels. I'm just kidding. But make no mistake, they are around us. The Bible is very, very clear about that. And some of you know what I'm talking about. There are supernatural forces at play. Now, this is the issue. The primary responsibility or power or delegation of this earth is not from the enemy. It's from God's given it to mankind. So wherever God places you is your greatest level of authority. God's placed humanity upon the planet. And so what God works through human beings to accomplish his will in concert together. I've heard people say, it's all God, it's all God. I did nothing, it's all God. Well, that's not necessarily true. I heard of a farmer that had a field, and all of a sudden he planted his crops, and it was a phenomenal field, and someone comes up to him the next day, next year, wow, look what God did to your field. He said, you should have seen the field last year when God had it. There was nothing here. And that's not being sacrilege. What it's being is truthful, that God provides the principles, he provides the seed, he provides the rain, he provides the sunshine, but we have to work in concert with him. And God delegates authority to us. And God will not work. Much what God does is through us in concert and community with him. Now, he can do more, but he chooses to do that. The enemy is the same way, but even less so. He has less power and less jurisdiction. The only way the enemy gets control is if he gets us to believe a lie and live a lie. Lie, he's called the father of lies. Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. So if the truth can set you free, then a lie can hold you in bondage. Exactly. And so what the enemy does is he lies to us. If he can get us to believe a lie, like you're no good and God can't use you, you believe it up here, guess what happens? The thoughts, unfortunately, through a period of time, begin to go from your head to your subconscious. And psychologists and sociologists tell us that your subconscious does not know the difference between what's true and false. What's ever in your subconscious, it believes. That's why you can fly at night when you're dreaming, okay? And so what happens is, if we start believing a lie, it goes from our conscious mind to our subconscious mind. Now it can start pushing buttons in our life. Why is it when you hear a song, like the other day I heard the song from Top Gun, Take My Breath Away, I'm dating myself, and I remember being in the theater with this young lady holding her hand. Okay, that's beside the point. But anyhow, I remember that, and I went back to being 17 and having my parents' car and going to the theater with my friends and eating popcorn. I mean, it was like I could smell the popcorn. Why? Because that time I had and back in that time went to my subconscious. It's kind of in the underlining, and it can play, can push the buttons on my emotions a little bit. That's because something gets inside of your subconscious. So if you begin to believe a lie, the lies can control you. The enemy understands that. He's a liar, a thief, and a killer. And he knows he's got no chance to go against God. He is the master terrorist. And so how does he get us? He gets us by believing a lie. Now, there's something else I want to say about terrorists. You do not negotiate with terrorists because they have no integrity. So if a terrorist wants to talk to you, know what you need to do? Blow his or her head off with a faith gun. You don't mess with terrorists. The moment you make a provisions for a terrorist, they will take advantage of you. I wish our government would get understanding of that. You do not negotiate with killers. They have no integrity. They're liars. You do not negotiate with the enemy. And once you begin to negotiate, listen, he is a master salesperson. He's incredible. And this is what I've learned. And I've learned that I learned this in sales, by the way. I used to sell Bibles door-to-door and educational books in Texas when I was 18 years old to help support college. And they taught me in the sales school, you got to ask questions. Who's ever asking the question is winning the argument or is in control of the situation. So the enemy can start asking you questions and have you doubting. So you're going to see that in a few moments. So please, I want to help you, please, to understand there's a misnomer out there that the devil's so strong. He's not that strong. He's as strong as we let him become. He's a terrorist. A terrorist uses fear and intimidation to gain control. And the way that he gets access to our life is through the open door of lies. If you believe the lies, you'll invite the flies. Okay? Well, that was pretty good. All right, let's go ahead and open our Bibles. I just wanted to kind of play the groundwork for those of you new here and wondering what's going on. There is a spiritual world out there. Absolutely. Okay, now, let's go to 1 John 2:16. This is what it says, the Bible. And this is the Apostle John speaking. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Those are the three primary ways the enemy gets access to our lives by either the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, or the pride of life. Today, we're going to talk about the lust of the eyes. We're going to talk about four different elements, primarily three with an extra one at the end, but the three main doors. And when I talk about doors, they're the major doors the enemy gets in. Now, we talked about the first one several weeks ago. I encourage you to go to cornerstonecheshire.com. People ask me, do we have DVDs and CDs? No, we do not. We probably should. I guess we've gone to the digital age and everything's on the website. So you can go to cornerstonecheshire.com and you can listen to or watch the previous messages to catch up. But I did one on pride, which I think is really more comprehensive, and I don't need to go back there again. But pride's the master key. Let's leave it at that. So it's the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And today we're talking about the lust of the eyes. And today, the lust of the eyes, we're talking about the first open door. And the first open door in that would be greed. The first open door of the lust of the eyes is called greed. Greed means I need. My name is greed. Okay? Greed is you want something. According to Webster, good old Webster said this, a selfish and excessive desire for more of something as money than is needed. I want to have it all. Greed, right? Greed will control you. Greed will make you miserable. Greed will make you in competition with every person that's around you. If someone is winning, you're not happy because you want it all. Greed. And so I want to show you this right here in the scriptures from Genesis. We're going to look at some instances in the Old Testament and the New Testament about how the enemy can get a trap at this. Now, I'm going to bring something up today that is very controversial, but it's in the Bible. And because it's in the Bible, I have an obligation to express it and to teach it and to show you what it says. Because if I do not preach the Bible, it's malpractice. You can lose your license in the medical field by doing malpractice. And so I would, in my mind, I lose my legitimacy as being a pastor by leaving certain things out of the scriptures. I've also tested my heart on this issue as well. And I'm very confident that I'm bringing it to you with no ulterior motives. You'll know what I'm talking about in a few moments. So, first thing is greed. Pride is the parent of the son or daughter of greed. Pride is the parent of greed, okay? So pride's the big one. And pride gives the sustenance and the incubation of greed comes from the parent of pride. That's how it happens. So in Genesis 3:1, we can see what happens through Adam and Eve, which is a great way to look at it. Okay, let's go ahead and turn to Genesis chapter 3, starting at verse 1. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord had made. And he said to the woman, here we go, here's a salesman. And what does he do? He asks questions. That's how you, if you want to know how to win an argument with your wife or husband, ask questions. I'm giving you a little secret. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree in the garden? Little side lesson here. God never said you can't eat every tree in the garden. He said you can't eat of one. So what does the enemy do? He makes God's requirements seem unreasonable. God does not want you having fun in church. You're supposed to wear ties. And by the way, did you know there's a part in church history, they thought tithes were from the devil because they point to hell. I'm not making this stuff up. And John Calvin, the church reformer, called the pipe organ the bagpipes of the devil. Now they're revered. Anyhow, just a little side note about that. What does it have to do with anything? Nothing. Just let me have an ADD moment for a second. Would you please indulge me for a moment, squirrel? Okay, let's go on. I had my caffeine this morning. I was fasting caffeine. Now I'm back in espresso again. Praise God. There's an anointing coming from the pulpit, and it's all have to do with the bean. I'm having fun. We can have fun in church. Can we have fun a little bit? Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you for having fun. All right. Let's go on. This is a tough topic, so I need all the laughter I can get to get through it. Now, the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you should not eat of any tree in the garden? Of course not. He's exaggerating the prohibition. And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, middle of the garden, God said, you should not eat, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Of course, you're having dialogue. A terrorist comes to you. You do not negotiate with terrorists. What is she doing? She's negotiating with a terrorist. There's no winning negotiating with a terrorist. So, here we go. Has God indeed said? The woman said no. You should not eat lest you die. Verse 4, the serpent said to the woman, you will surely not die. And guess what? He's absolutely correct. She would not die at that moment, but she would die later. So the greatest truth, the greatest lie has a lot of truth in it, you see? And that's what the enemy does. He takes the truth and he just put a little arsenic in there, 2%, enough to kill you, but we'll just put it in there so you die slowly. So this is what happens. And you will surely not die, verse 5. For God knows that the day you eat of it, your eyes, the lust of the eyes, will be opened, and you will be like God. Now, our whole purpose of Cornerstone Church is to help us become like God, but not to become God. So he uses a religious, uses religion to kind of steeper in us. See, we're supposed to be like God. For God knows in the day you eat, your eyes will be open and you'll be like God, knowing both good and evil. What a noble thing to do. Of course, they didn't know what evil was back in those days. What's evil? Evil's live spelled backwards. And this is exactly what the enemy is trying to do. Verse 6, when the woman saw, here we go, the lust of the eyes, that the tree was good for food and it was pleasant to the eyes, the tree is desirable to make one wise, that's pride. She took of the fruit and ate, that's the lust of the flesh, all three there. She also gave to her husband, who was a bonehead, just sitting there. What's the deal with Adam? Whatever you want, honey. I guess that's how they teach you in marriage course. Whatever you want, honey, that's the way to happiness, I suppose. But he got us in big trouble. He should have stood up to his wife. Satan's strategy is to get you to doubt and question the word of God. I know the Bible says you shouldn't. You should forgive. But this person, what they've done is unforgiving. I know the Bible says that before you have consummate a relationship, you should be married. But, you know, it's only a piece of paper. It's okay. You go ahead and live together for a while. It's okay. It's no big deal. The reason that God says it, because he loves us, doesn't want to see us hurt. Right? So did God really say? And it's all the time. And he's really amazing because he'll start using strategy. The more you talk to the enemy, he knows us really well. Listen, I know a lot of you from Facebook. I know deep, dark secrets about. We had a person in our church that they had a teenager. And their teenager was drinking alcohol and going to parties. But they put it on Facebook. So I said to the dad, hey, I don't know if you've noticed, but, you know, your child is apparently hanging out with people that are toking it up and smoking, and look, it's right here. And the person was really upset that I was gossiping. It's on Facebook, okay? So if I can look at Facebook and know about your life, what about the enemy? He's got all these records, too. He's got your family line he can look at. He knows your past. They can just look up on the computer of the hell. I don't know where that is, right? And they can find all the stuff on you. And so what they'll do is they'll try to find a way to entrap you and how to get you. The more you talk to sin, the more it will use the opportunity to fool you in believing its lie. Once you believe its lie, you're not going to be very sly. Okay, here we go. Move forward. I know, it's corny. I know. So when the woman saw that it was good for food, it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took it, she gave it to her husband. So Satan's strategy is get you to doubt or question the word of God. The Bible says that, but I'm different than this set of circumstances. You do not negotiate with the devil because he'll always win if you negotiate. The only negotiation she gave him was a slam door and a slice off his head with the word of God. That's how you deal with the enemy. That's kind of violent, Pastor. Well, that's what you have to do with the enemy because the enemy don't play with the enemy. What I mean by that is the word of God says, I'm not going to talk to you. Slam. If ISIS knocks on your door, you don't invite them in for tea, right? But the enemy's smarter than that. He'll come as a beautiful salesperson. I have a pyramid scheme. Okay, anyhow, let's move forward. Genesis 2:9. And out of the ground, God made every tree that groweth pleasant. And the word pleasant, by the way, sometimes could mean Eve in Hebrew is greed or lust in the sight for food. The tree of life was also in the middle of the garden with the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Eve thought that something else might make her happy. I want more. It's called greed. I need. My name is greed. Right? I want more. I want to be more like God. And it all sounds noble and great, but the legitimate desire is skewed by the enemy. And as a result of that, he gets power and grace in our grace to do his disgrace in our lives. That's what happens. Boy, I'm really rhyming a lot this morning. I was a poet. I didn't even know it. Okay, let's move forward. The first sin was taken to what was belonging to God. So God will test you, okay? That's what will happen. Now, why would God, she said, why would God hold out on me? God's holding out on you. God's not giving you everything you need. You should eat this fruit. You should take it. You want to be wise. God's holding out from you. You can't, you need to take what's yours, young lady. Come on, take what's yours. And what will often happen is God will often give you a test before he brings you blessing. And one of the major things of tests, the number for testing in the Bible is numerology, by the way. It's part of some truth to it. Seven's a, you know, perfect number. Well, 10 is often in Scripture the number for testing. And they're all throughout Scripture. I'll show you in a few moments. Now, the word tithe means 10%. That's what it means, 10. It's like saying, what does 10 mean? Well, 10 means 10. So tithe means 10. And so one of the tests that God gives us is that I want to show you a couple things real quickly here about 10 in Scripture. I'm going to ask you a question, and I want you, to, if you could be so kind, to answer for me, okay? Is that all right, everybody? All right. We have to be interactive here this morning. Let me ask you a couple questions. You can say it out loud. It's all right. You can talk in church once in a while. Okay. How many plagues were there in Egypt with Pharaoh? How many? 10. Come on. You can be a little more aggressive than that. Come on. You're Italian. Where's your, come on. How many plagues were in Egypt with Pharaoh?
10.
All right. How many commandments are there?
10.
Now, you may not know this, but it's pretty obvious. How many times did God test the Israelites in the desert?
10.
That's not, okay. How many times was Jacob's wages changed?
10.
Thank you. How many days was Daniel tested?
10.
How many virgins were tested in Matthew 25?
10.
How many days of testing are mentioned in Revelation? How many disciples are there? No, there's 12. Sorry, I'm just having a little fun. Can I have fun here this morning? This is a tough topic. I need all the humor I can get on this, but this is a serious topic. But it's a test. God will often give us a test, and the number 10 is there for a reason. And so I want to show you, God represents things in Scripture. And one of the things was a tithe of the first child. You'll see what I'm talking about here. Exodus 13, verses 1 and 2. You'll see in a moment. Just bear with me. If you don't agree with me, that's fine. I mean, I'm all right with that. It's no big deal. I know some great Christians that don't agree with me, even though they're wrong. It's fine. It's fine to disagree, but you know what? It's why not look at Scripture and come to it and give it an opportunity to speak to us. So Exodus 13, 1 and 2. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, consecrate to me all the firstborn, whatever opens the womb among the children of Israel, both of man and beast is mine. Okay, that's what the Bible says. Exodus 23, 19 says the following. It says, the first fruits of your land you shall bring into the house of the Lord your God. The first fruits you shall bring to the Lord your God. For example, what does it say here? It says, you shall bring it into the house of the Lord. It doesn't say you shall bring it to the televangelist. It says, bring it to the house of the Lord where you're worshiping. All right, the Bible talks about tithing. It does not say give the tithe. It says bring the tithe. Now, why would the Bible say bring the tithe instead of give the tithe? It's because the tithe is the Lord's. It's not ours. It's not negotiable according to Scripture. Okay? You don't return it. You don't give it. You return it. So, let me ask you a question. If I were to borrow a car from someone, let's suppose I was going to borrow, I'm going to pick on Joe, the incredible sound guy in the back there. He also has a small group for young adults. He's a great man. He's got great daughters. Tremendous guy. Let's suppose he says, Pastor, I said, Joe, my car's in the shop, which does happen occasionally. Can I borrow your brand new SUV four-wheel drive? He says, sure, Pastor, you can borrow it. I'm going to Hawaii with my family, so I don't need it. So he's taking his whole family to Hawaii. Wouldn't that be nice, Joe? Anyhow, I drive his car for 2 weeks. He comes back from Hawaii, and then I decide to pick him up from the airport, and I drive him to his house. I say, here, Joe, I'm going to give you this Santa Fe. It's yours. I'm giving you this SUV. It's yours. What you talking about, Pastor? That's what he'd say to me. And say, what are you talking about? You're not giving it to me. It's mine. No, I'm giving it to you. How ridiculous would that be? So when the Bible says bring the tithe, you're bringing what's already God's, okay? That's what's a part of it. And do you realize this? Let me show you through Cain and Abel. Do you know the first murder in the church was over giving? I don't think it's a surprise that this is still a controversial area in the Bible, because giving gets people upset and showed us church. The first murder was over a church service, and it was not over the singing of the hymns or praise and worship choruses. It was over the tithes and the offerings. Let's show you right here in the scripture, Genesis 4, verse 3 through 7. And in the process of time went on, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat. That's why you're not supposed to eat fat, you're supposed to give it to the Lord. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. Now, Abel had flocks of the field. Cain was a farmer. Now, they're supposed to bring the animal for sacrifice, but he didn't think it was fair. So I'm going to give God my grain and not going to give him my calf. I'm not going to do that. So he disobeyed God and did not give what God had asked. There had to be a blood sacrifice back in that day, as a way to communicate what had to happen in the future. Verse 6, so the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? He was jealous of his brother Abel. Why? Because Abel's sacrifice was accepted and appreciated by God, while Cain's was not. There are people in church, well, that's not fair. How come they're up there teaching? I should be up there. I've been coming for 50. And all of a sudden, there's like this jealousy that begins to happen, right? And it happened, by the way, over worship. The first murder took place at a church service. If you think about it, that's really what happened. So, God says to him, so the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? And why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? Just do what I've asked you to do, Cain. Listen to this. And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door. Let me in. Your brother's a jerk. Let me in. Who does he think he is? You know, it's not really fair. You know, why does he has it? But he's got cattle, so it's no big deal for him to give one of his cattle. I don't have any cattle. I'm a farmer. I do plants. It's not really fair that I'm gonna give God my plants, not my cattle. That's for the food. I'm not gonna do that, God. And hey, you know what? Your brother's this. Go get your brother. Many times the enemy comes and he knocks at our door. It's that terrorist again. But the problem with the terrorist is, terrorist looks pretty good. Terrorist, it looks like a real smooth talking, silver tongued salesperson that comes to your door and tries to get in. And he opens the door, doesn't he? And what happens? He actually kills his brother over a tithe and offering. That's the truth of the matter. This is what happened, because he wasn't accepted by God. So the word desire means to rule. It's at your The devil wants to he wants to rule you. So the first sin is to take what belongs to God because of the lust of the eye, which causes jealousy. You see something, you want it, you take it, and you make it yours. In Leviticus 27:30, it says the following. And all the tithe, it means all of 10% of the land, whether the seed of the land or the fruit of the tree is the Lord's. It is holy. Holy means set apart to the Lord. Okay, now, this is what my wife and I do. We immediately tithe. I tithe to the Southern New England District because my pastor that oversees me and I help you, you know, the AG area here, I give it to the district council. And so I give 10% immediately. It takes out of my check immediately. I give it right away. And then we bring the tithe to them. And then we also give to the church. We give to other ministries and things that we give to this church. We give to the building and all that kind of fun stuff. But our tithe, we bring it to our overseers, the one that helps us to be part of this this fellowship, this cooperative fellowship that we're part of, which we'll find out today in 101 if you want to find out more. Okay? So greed is the first door open. And this is what begins to happen. Greed's the first door open. The second door that's open is unbelief, okay? Now, why would a person or believer in Christ not tithe? Oh, pastor, you want to drive a fancy car and get a jet. No, I don't want a fancy car or a jet, but if you want to give me one, I'll sell it and give it to somebody else. But it's not about that. I can tell you with all clarity, all sincerity, I have no desire to manipulate people. Give me $1,000 and God will give you. No, I don't believe that nonsense, okay? It's not true. God can bless us in many ways. I'm a very wealthy man. I might not be a millionaire, but I had the awesome, most awesome wife I could ask for. I had 3 beautiful children. I got an awesome church. I get the pastor and hang out with every week. I'm a pretty blessed man. And that's, you can't buy that kind of stuff. So we're not talking about driving a new car. You know, we're not talking about that, okay? I just feel right now, calling right now, and God will, no, we're not going to do that nonsense, okay? And I've tested my heart, and I'm telling you, this is what the Word of God says. It's the Word of God says this. It's unbelief. So people disagree, and they're good Christians because they don't believe what it says. I want you to notice that tithing came before the law. And the word tithe, by the way, appears 8 times in the New Testament. And even Jesus, which we'll read later on, says it in the red letter, which means he said it. 8 times. You know that other words like steal were mentioned 11 times, but 3 times it was repeated. Do you know the virgin birth is only mentioned twice, but we believe it? Why is it when the Bible talks about, well, it's about money, you know, money's bad. And no, look what the Bible has to say. In Joshua 6:19, it says the following. But all the silver and gold and vessels of bronze and iron are consecrated to the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. Now, what was the treasury of the Lord? It was the tabernacle. The first person they went against was Jericho after they crossed the Jordan River. That was the first. And they were supposed to give it to God. Joshua 7:11 through 12. Israel has sinned. And they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have even taken some of the accursed things and have both stolen and deceived, and they have also put it among their own stuff. Instead of taking, they're supposed to give it all to God. That was God's command back then. The first tithe of their conquest, they're supposed to give all to God. The first offering, if you will. And they took what was God's. Verse 12. Therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies. Why? Because the lust of the eyes, this guy named Achan, had an Achan heart, and as a result, he got pride, he got lust, and he took what was his, took what was God's. It says, for they even took some of the accursed things and have both stolen and deceived, and they have also put it among their own stuff. Verse 12, therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turn their backs before their enemies because they had become doomed to destruction. Neither will I be with you anymore unless you destroy the accursed among you. God wants to bless us, but if we don't listen to him, we lose the blessing. Why? Because God doesn't want us to be consumed with greed. He wants us to understand that everything comes from him. We have to return what's his. It is a test. It is a test. We're most like God when we give. For God so loved the world, he took. No. For God so loved the world, he what? He gave. And this is the fun. I'm going to ask you a question here this morning. And for those watching it at our television audience at home, let me ask you a question. Have you ever given something to somebody with no strings attached in secret? How did it feel? It felt right, didn't it? Ah, it's like, wow, this is what giving is all about. When you give something to somebody, I gave them that and they never called me back. what does that cause? Tension, trying to control, right? But when you give to somebody, say, you know what? I'm going to give it to you. I don't care. I'm going to forgive you. I don't care if you hate me for the rest. I do care, but I'm not going to look for you to do anything back to me. I'm going to give it to you. No strings attached. It brings freedom, my friends. It brings freedom. So that's what begins to happen. And it's very interesting that they cannot stand before their enemies. And, you know, think of it this way. God begins with G, which is like give. And Satan begins with S, which means steal. So when you steal, you're opening the door to the enemy because he's a stealer. Not a Pittsburgh stealer, but a stealer. I've taught on this passage very many times, but I saw something new, afresh for the first time this week that I did not see. I'm going to share with you in a little bit. But please turn to Malachi, chapter 3, verse 6 through 11. Jesus said, not one jot, not one punctuation mark from the Old Testament will be abolished. I did not come to destroy the word, I come to fulfill it. So let's look at Malachi 3, 6 through 11. Verse 6, I am the Lord and I do not change. That's what he says, I do not change, I am the Lord. That is why your sons of Jacob are not already destroyed. Yet from the days of your fathers, you have gone away from my ordinances. Ordinances means the ordinary proper ways of doing things. In other words, you've gone away from what I've told you to do. You have gone away from my ordinances and you have not kept them. The Bible says, return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you say, in what way shall we return? How am I supposed to return you, God? What do we do wrong? Will a man rob God? Of course I would never rob God. Notice how many times the word rob is used in this passage. Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and in offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even the whole nation. Bring all the tithes. It says bring. This does not say give the tithe. It says bring the tithe. Why? Because it's God's anyhow. You give the offerings and you bring the tithe. God has miraculously said it. You can live more on 90% than you can on 100%. I've known companies. I've known people. I've been around for about over four decades now. I can say that. And I've seen the most successful people I have ever known, have the most successful families, are successful in all the ways. I see they are massive givers, hands down. I've seen it growing up. I've seen it in a church. I've seen it, and my wife and I, we've seen it. The most successful people we know are givers because it opens God. They're just free with what God's given them. They give it away. And so how has it happened? But you say, in what way? Will man rob God? It's your tithes and your offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even the whole nation. Verse 10, bring a tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house, which is the church, a local church, my house. And try me, test me. The Bible says you shall not test the Lord your God. But here it says, test me. Now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven. It doesn't just say the doors, the windows of heaven. And pour out such a blessing that there will be not enough room to receive it. Does not mean you're going to be driving Rolls Royces and Bentleys, but it means God will bless you, give you what you need. He'll bless your family. Look what the Bible says here. And there will be room, here we go. Let's read it in verse 10. Bring all the tithes into my storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out such a blessing that there will be no room enough to receive it. And if you act now, okay, I will also rebuke the devourer. Who's the devourer? The enemy. For your sakes, that he will not be able to destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vines fail to bear fruit in your field, says the Lord of hosts. Basically, he's saying, listen, I know we don't have vines and all that kind of, but your cars, your automobiles, your taxes, your 401k, your taxes, no one want that, but you know, your money in the bank, I'm going to watch over it and make sure you're going to be okay because you trust me. And my friends, I would tell you this without a shadow of a doubt, that as a result of us bringing our tithe and giving offerings, my wife and I are like, okay, God, you take care of it. Sometimes the pressure comes on us for money. Things break down, cars break down, and all that kind of fun stuff. And I just feel a freedom that it doesn't control me. Let me explain to you why money is such a big deal. Benjamin Franklin says the following. Time is the stuff life is made of. Time is the stuff life is made of, okay? Now, when you go for an employer, what do you give them? You give them your time. And as a result of giving your time, what do you get back? Money. Okay, so here's the equation. You give time, you get money, right? So what does money represent? Your time. What does time represent? Your life. This is why it goes right to the crux of the matter. Now, I saw something I'd never seen before. He uses the word, there's a difference between the word rob and theft. If you go to someone's garage and they're not home, you take something, that is theft. If someone is home, you're robbing them. And it says here in the Bible, you have robbed me because God is in the house. It's significant. And you know what Jesus had to say about tithing? I'm going to show you in Matthew 23:23. What sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you're careful to tithe 10% of the tiniest income from your herb gardens, but you ignore the most important aspects of the law, justice, mercy, and faith. Now, I wish he would stop it, but he doesn't. What does he say? You should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the more important things either. So that's what Jesus has to say. That one scripture does it for me. It's in the red. I see it. It's in the Bible. I am God, I do not change. Here's the third principle, fear. The lust of the eyes, the first one, and here we are, we have the fear. And what is fear? Fear is very, very powerful, isn't it? Fear, that's what terrorists does. Terrorists control us by fear. The enemy controls us by fear. How does that happen? Well, let me show you how it happened. Through a guy named Judas, you might have heard of him. Luke 22, verse 3 through 5. You know the story. Judas was one of the 12 disciples. Maybe you don't know the story. There was a guy that was the money guy. He was the treasurer of Jesus' ministry. Let's go ahead and read. Then Satan entered Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12 disciples, and he went to the leading priest and the captains of the temple guard to discuss the best way to betray Jesus. And listen to this. They were delighted, and they promised to give him money. Now, there's another situation where right before this, Judas let fear control him. In John 12, 1 through 6. See, what was happening was Jesus wasn't doing what he thought he should do. He could see that what was happening. He saw the writing on the wall that Christ is going to be arrested. He saw it. So verse chapter 12 of John, verse 1 through 6. Then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus, who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead. There they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with them. Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil, anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped it with her hair. And the whole house was filled with the fragrance of the oil. But one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, said, Simon's son, who would betray him, said the following, why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? I hear that all the time. Well, we should give it to the poor. Let me ask you a question. You know how much a denarii was? That was the equivalent of a year's wage. So according to what I read this past week at Mr. Google, whoever Google is, the average income of Americans, of a household, is $50,000. So basically, she broke open 50 grand at the feet of Jesus. And Judas was indignant. That should be given to the poor. And why did he have such an attitude that in instructing Jesus? And we'll talk about arrogance. Instructing. What happens next? Look at this. Verse 6. This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief. Who is Satan? A thief. And he had the money box. He had the offering plate. He took him with him. And he had money box, and he used to take what was put in it. He was a thief. He was a thief. So what happened? He took money. He said, what it should have been given to God, he took for himself. Are we thieves, my friend? According to Malachi, are we thieves? Many don't tithe because of fear. Oh, I don't know if I'll be able to pay the bills. You know what I found out with everything? And by the way, if I don't schedule time to read my Bible and pray, guess what happens? I don't do it. Something else will grab my attention, and I'll be busy. Some crisis will happen. The sink won't work. This won't happen. The kids need this. Kids need that. And it's the same thing with that. If you don't give God the first, you're never going to do it. You got to bring the tithe because it's God's anyhow. It's often fear. Now, let me show you something else in Matthew 26:15. And this is what This is what Judas told the priest. And he said this, "What are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you?" And they counted him out 30 pieces of silver. Now, there's something significant about 30 pieces of silver I'm going to show you in a few moments. Let's go ahead and look at Matthew 27, 3 through 10. You're going to see it here. "Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that he had been condemned, was remorseful and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, 'I have sinned by betraying innocent blood.' And what did they do? The priest gave them part of the tithe to pay for Judas to lie and to go after Jesus. So, verse 4, saying, 'I have sinned and betrayed innocent blood.' And they said, 'What is that to us? You see to it.' Then he threw down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hung himself." You realize that if he would have repented, God would have received him again. The difference between condemnation and conviction. Verse 6, "But the chief priest took the silver pieces and said, 'It's not lawful to put them into the treasury,'" even though they took it from the treasury to betray, "because they're a price of blood." So that's what happened. My question is this: will we betray Jesus over 10%? I'm just asking the question. It's in the Bible. Do you know what 30 pieces of silver represents? I'm so glad you asked, because it's found here in Exodus 21, 32. This is part of the law of Moses at the time. "But if the ox gores a slave," in other words, kills a slave, "either male or female, the animal's owner must pay the slave's owner 30 pieces of silver." What was the price for a slave? 30 pieces of silver. What was the price of Judas? 30 pieces of silver. It leads to slavery. When you choose not to obey God's word, you put yourself under subjection. God says, "I can't rebuke a devourer." He comes to you and says, "God, they're stingy, they're prideful. I have access, okay? You only have access to this point, but you do." This is what happens. And so when you are generous and when you bring the tithe and you give offerings, you are slamming the door of the enemy upon you. Very, very important we understand. You close the door. Now, if you've never tithed before, you don't have to make recompense. Just start today. Just start today. Just start when you can, right away. 1 Timothy 6:10 says this, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. For with it some have strayed from their faith, greediness, and pierced themselves with many sorrows." It's a huge door. I'm going to ask if the ushers at this point, and usherettes, could hand out the elements for communion. I want to talk about another area, a door that opens up. And that's the door of unforgiveness. Because you know what? Forgiveness, what happens? How do you forgive somebody? You have to do what? You have to forgive, let them off the hook. You have to give something to somebody when you forgive, right? So part of forgiveness comes in being a generous person. A huge door is the lust of the eyes, but even bigger the door is unforgiveness and bitterness. You know what it says in Matthew 6:15? That's what it says. The Lord's Prayer was just spoken about. "Father, forgive me like I forgive others." And then Jesus goes back and summarizes the Lord's Prayer and says the following, which is really, really sobering. It's what he says. "But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive you of your sins." What does that mean? I don't know, but I don't want to find out. Do you? If God doesn't forgive me, that's pretty significant, is it not? So we have to forgive others, lest God won't forgive us. Jesus tells a parable of a man that owed him money. He let him off the hook. He found another guy that owed him very little money. He grabbed him and says, "You need to pay me." When the king found out about it, you know what he said? In Matthew 18, 34. The angry king sent the man to prison, he said, to be tortured until he paid the entire debt. Do you realize if you don't forgive others, you give the enemy access to your life to torture you? There are people that are sick, people that have mental, physical, financial, relational problems because they do not forgive. They're under a curse because God says, if you don't forgive others, I won't forgive you. My friends, it's very important that we forgive. It's part of giving. You have to forgive. Genesis 4:7. "You will be accepted if you do what's right. But if you refuse to do what's right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at your door, seeking to control you." My friends, don't forgive them. Don't forgive them. That's unforgivable. What they've done is wrong. you don't forgive them. Forgiving someone does not mean that what they did was correct. It's taking the hook out of your mouth and giving you freedom. The devil is looking for an access point. He does it through greed. He does it through pride. And he does it through unforgiveness. Choose to forgive today. The first murder in the Bible, you know what it was over? It was over jealousy, unforgiveness. He couldn't forgive his brother. How dare he rise above me in the church? I don't like that. I don't like my brother. He had unforgiveness. He had greed because he didn't want to give up what was his. So he thought. You see that? See, it's all tied together. My friends, we need to forgive. I'm going to ask right now, I'm going to ask you a question before we take the elements. How are you with God? Have you given your life to Christ? I mean, you may know about God, but have you actually given your life to Christ? It's not just a knowing it intellectually, but it's about handing over the keys of your life. Say, God, I'm no longer in charge. I give my life to you. It's real simple, folks. You don't have to get your act together first. Just give him your life now, and God will help you to become the person he's called you to become. Because one day, you're going to have to give an answer to your life. We have a dear friend of the church that had a relative die at the age of 60. I mean, no indication at all. Just drop of a massive heart attack. Thank God the person was saved and a believer. But you do not know when's your last day. Are you ready to meet God? Today can be that day. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads in reverence for everyone else. And I'm going to pray a prayer. Today can be your day of salvation today for you. You want to repeat this prayer and mean it from your heart. It's not the words, it's your heart connecting with the truth of what we're going to pray right now. Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died on the cross for me to pay for the sins that I cannot pay for. I thank you that there's nothing I can do to save myself. You've paid it. I receive your forgiveness of my sins. Cleanse me of everything I've ever done wrong, both known and unknown. And I choose this day to give my life to you afresh. Have your way in me. I declare that my life is no longer my own. I'm living for you with your help. In Jesus' name, with every head bowed, say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer for the first time or in a long time. I just made a recommitment. Just see, quick show of hands. Say, Pastor, just so I know how to help. Anyone else this morning? Thank you. Anyone else this morning? Thank you for being on. Anyone else this morning? Say, Pastor, you know what? Your heart's beating, but you know what? When you show you did it, it will do something. Anyone else this morning? Say, Pastor, that was me. Maybe you're watching online. You can click on the connection card. I gave my life to Christ. So today's a new day for you. I also want to encourage you this morning that the body of Christ, if you have unforgiveness towards someone, you're not willing to forgive, please don't take this today. The Bible says those who do not discern the body of Christ correctly bring condemnation upon themselves. But Jesus said the following, this is my body, which has been broken for you. He loves us so much that he broke for us. Take, eat, this is my body. After they had dinner, Jesus said, this is a new covenant. This is a new way of doing things. What washes away our sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ. What sets us free? And we've seen people get healed by taking communion. I don't know what's going on in your body right now. I don't know why. I sense someone's got an issue with, I know this is kind of vague, but I just sense someone has an indigestion problem that they just can't get free of. I believe right now, if you receive it, God's going to heal you. So let's take a drink, everybody. Thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you for your body. Thank you for your blood. Lord, we thank you that we've heard your truth today, your scripture, Lord. We want to give everything to you, Lord, and hold nothing back. Lord, I pray that the strongholds of the enemy be broken of our back. Lord, we choose to obey you by bringing the tithe, because it's not ours, it's yours. Everything of you is yours anyhow, but in particular, Lord, you've asked us to bring the tithe and to give offerings. Lord, we choose to honor you. We choose to forgive others that have done wrong against us. Lord, we leave them in your hands. And Father, thank you for the freedom that is ours. I cancel the enemy's attack upon many people, Father. We realize he's a terrorist, and we're sorry for giving him access by being disobedient to you. We choose to be under your covering and your protection. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask you if you could all stand and ask that the prayer team will make their way down. If you want prayer for anything at all, if you prayed that prayer today, we have a special gift for you. If you could do me a favor, if you could fill out this card, and say, I prayed that prayer today. I've asked Christ in my heart, if you could put it, give it to one of the people up front here, or put it in one of the boxes. We have a gift for you. I want to help you along your path. I'm so delighted that you chose to give the gift to God today. It's the best decision you'll ever make. We're going to ask the prayer team to make their way up. We're going to have a concluding song, and after that, we'll dismiss. Dismiss you. If you want to stay, and if the band wants to play more, they can. If you want more prayer, we'd love to pray with you. Otherwise, we dismiss you this morning to have some fellowship. We'd love to have you come to the Grove Track, which is right on the right-hand side of the conference booth. Thank you for being attentive today, and thank you for helping me to deliver a controversial message, which I know is from God. God bless you this morning. Thank you so much.